present some of our work. I just see that Jaroslav didn't make it yet, so stay for fixed a little bit. Okay, so the topic of my talk is on Majoranas and hopefully also on parafermions. And I understand that you got already an introduction, a pedagogical, into the subject of Majoranas by Bert Halperin on Saturday or Sunday. So I will still repeat a few things, and Jaroslav also told me to be pedagogical. I don't have pedagogical slides, I just will speak more slowly. So that's my attempt. But then I don't know if I can cover my topic. So I should acknowledge my collaborators here. Dikla Irina Tinovaya, a new colleague in Basel, and then also Thijs Kopman, he is also supposed to be here. And Sudi Consulciale and Denis Chevalier is also here, and people in Japan, Peter Stano, Chin Su, and my experimental colleague, Ernst Meyer. Okay, so the outline of my talk is first I introduce some basic concepts about Majorana fermions and nanowires, and then in particular I want to focus on the Majoranas recently reported to be observed in iron atom chains on lead. And maybe I skip this little part and we'll come then to the parafermions, the extension of Majorana fermions. So Majorana fermions, they have been of great interest in recent years because of quantum computing. There's a scheme which is called topological quantum computing. It consists of moving these quasi-particles around each other and the timeline looks like grading, and it doesn't really matter what kind of paths you take, and that is referred to as topological stability, and it was believed that it's very useful for quantum games. I will not say much more about that. That's basically one of the motivations in the field. But the study of these topological excitations is interesting by itself. So the basic ingredients in this field is topological superconductivity. Either it's given to you, which is very difficult actually to get in nature, or you basically engineer it, you design it by taking the right components and putting them together, building hybrid systems. And the basic ingredients for that is an S-wave superconductor, just a standard one, and very important is some sort of a spin texture. So spin plays a very important role here, and an S-wave superconductor is just single pairing, and you need to get something more out of it, a little bit of triplet pairing, and this you can achieve when you add some non-trivial spin texture in the system. And spin texture can be provided by several mechanisms. There's an intrinsic one, spin-orbit, Mashba spin-orbit interaction, but I will also argue that you can do completely without any spin-orbit interaction, just replacing essentially the Mashba by some external rotating magnetic field, and intrinsically if you have spin impurities, magnetic impurities, they can also form non-trivial textures acting on the electrons. So, so the spin-orbit interaction, let's start with that first. So what we have in mind is a wire, one-dimensional wire with a few transverse channels, and we are, let's say, the lowest mode, transverse mode, and we apply the magnetic field along the wire, and we have a spin-orbit interaction like this here, a field which points in that direction, defining the quantization axis of the spin-orbit of the Rashba field. In one dimension, that becomes very simple. So it's a term which is linear in the momentum, Px, along the wire, and in some axis sigma z is the spin Pauli matrix in z direction perpendicular to the wire axis. Then you get this famous Rashba spectrum of a spin up and a spin down, and the spin orbit interaction basically just shifts them against each other, so the pulls them apart. So the spin up is shifted to the left, the spin down parabola is shifted to the right. Without any magnetic field, this would have no effect. Basically, you can gauge that away. But when you apply the magnetic field in this direction, perpendicular to the Rashba direction, then you open a gap at k equals zero, and sometimes this is referred to as a helical gap, illustrates that spectrum is written down here. And so that forms the basics of much I will discuss now. But what is very important is that in this scheme, we also need to have the chemical potential, the Fermi level, inside that gap. That's something you can tune. So by gates, change the density, you change the filling of the Fermi band, and that already tells you it's not so easy. Even if you have this Rush-Pass-Pirogue interaction available, you still need to tune. And if it's very low, if the Rush-Pass interaction, the strength here, alpha squared, if this is small, then you have to go very, very far down as the Fermi energy depletes the wire. If you have this order, then you get into problems. Also, what one should say is people have been working in this field for quite some time now, and the only value of this Rush-Pass interaction strength of this alpha experimentally is known from a Clapham dot measurement first done in Samuelson's group, and that revealed a spin orbit length of about 100 nanometers. Spin orbit length meaning that it's the distance you have to travel to turn your spin from up to down because of the spin orbit interaction. But it has never been possible to measure the rush bar in the wire itself directly so far. We're still hoping this will come on. Okay, then you add now superconductivity to this spectrum. So here I have plotted again that shifted parabola, the blue and the red, the solid line, and then I add now superconductivity is the whole part, the dashed line on top of it. And when I add superconductivity, then the system is fully gapped by proximity effect. So here's the setup, you have a wire, a superconductor, and it opens a gap. And the gap of the superconductor appears at the outer points of the Fermi points and also at zero. But because we also have a gap from the Zeeman field, there's a competition between the Zeeman field, which once opened the gap, and the superconductivity. And when you diagonalize the problem, I'll show you in a moment, then it's possible that this gap here, as a when you tune the Zeeman field, can actually close and then reopen. And this is the topological phase transition. So if the Zeeman field is zero, we are in the trivial S-wave type of superconducting phase, and if the set is larger, the Zeeman spectrum is larger than the superconducting gap, we invert the bands, and we are in the topological superconducting phase, and as a result, then at the ends of the wires or interfaces, we can get bound states or Majorana's. And Majorana's have first been written down as solutions of a topological superconductor by Wolowick in the vortex core of a P-wave superconductor, discussed then with spin orbit in two-dimensional systems, and then in nanowires by Luigi et al. And Ray Bucal. This triggered a lot of experiments, and in particular a very nice experiment by the Delft group, Leo Kohlenhoven. This is the setup from their experiment. Reported then first signatures of the Majorana's. There are a number of other groups and also groups working on topological insulators with similar effects that we see. So here's just a flash of these experimental data. Basically, if you have a bound state sitting here in this gap, then it is seen in the transport properties as an additional feature in this color plot as a function of magnetic field. We get an enhanced current through the system. This is a cut as a function of magnetic field, increasing magnetic field, and this is a zero bias peak, which is attributed to the existence of the Majorana Fermi. Now, so this is a little bit already history that happened in 2012, 4 years ago or so. And one can also ask, is there more than just a zero energy signature? Can we see more of the entire wave function of a Majorana? And for this, I go now a little bit into the structure of a Majorana, the internal structure, not only the energy is important. And for this, here I show again these two parabolas shifted and the superconducting part added like this. And it's very convenient to work in this problem by linearizing around the Fermi points, so they are three, here minus KSO, plus KSO. And the KSO is the wave factor associated with the spin orbit, and you have to tune it to the Fermi wave factor, so KF is equal to twice KSO. That's why we have this point here. And we get a nice linearization, so here's a fermion operator, which has a right and left goer at this point, K equals zero, so no phase, because K equals zero, and a left goal was the minus and the right goal is the plus and opposite spin. And then you can separate the contributions of the Hamiltonian to these points, so called the anterior branches. This is this one here. You get an effective Dirac Hamiltonian. Sigma refers now to the right and left goer space and eta to the particle hole space. So here's again the same term, and here's the superconducting gap. And we are in a basis where we have a right spin up and the left down, and the same for the hole. Then very similar for the exterior branch. And so you have a problem which is a 4x4 matrix, and this basically you can diagonalize and you can find then the eigenfunctions of this problem. And we are looking now for very particular solutions, namely solutions which are self-Hermitian. So we want to have a fermion operator, and I take the Hermitian conjugate of it gives this itself, and the square. This one. And this is expressed sometimes that the particle is its own antiparticle. Such a Majorana fermion can be thought of as the real part of a complex fermion, or the imaginary part of a complex fermion. Like a complex number, you have a real part, imaginary part, and the Majorana fermion is just one part of it. So it's not so difficult to get actually Majoranas. What is difficult is to get Majoranas which are stable. And you also would like to have Majoranas which are spatially separated. And I have no order. So here, again, this is the fermion basis in which we work. And so it's very generic here. And this is the associated wave function in that basis. And then we want to have an operator which satisfies this condition. And that imposes constraints on the components of the wave function, namely that the components have to satisfy, you have only two independent contributions here for the spin up and for the spin down, and then it's repeated by the whole contribution just by the complex object. So if you see this structure, then you know immediately that the fermion turns out to be a real fermion or a set condition. Good, so you diagonalize this Hamiltonian, and then you find also, I should say, that these Majoranas, they have almost no properties. They have zero charge, they have zero spin, it's a bound state, basically no mass, and therefore it's not so easy to detect them. So they do not react to electric fields, and they do not react to magnetic fields. So here is the solution of this 4x4 linear differential equation, the Hamiltonian I showed before. So this is what we call the Majorana fermion wave function. And it has these four components for the spin up, spin down, and the same for the hole. And you can see the structure. This is the complex conjugate of the first one, and here it's the same. And the same on this side. So the two contributions, one from the interior branch around k equals 0, and one from the exterior branch around ks 2 to 0. And what is interesting now is that they have decay lengths, because it's a localized state, it's lying inside the gap, it's not an extended state, it's a localized state at the edge of the system, and decays towards the bottom. And if you have a wire, then there's one Majorana sitting here with a decay length, and one sitting here with a decay length. And this is a solution where the Majoranas are so far from each other that they do not overlap. Otherwise they get splitting. And what is interesting now, that there are two decay lengths, and they are determined then by the corresponding gap of interior and exterior branch. And we will come back to this. So they also have oscillations, because we have a part which doesn't, and a part which does oscillate. And when you look then at the square of that function, you get interference terms. And so here's the exponential decay with two decay lengths and three like oscillations. Depending on material parameters. And so it would be nice actually to have some experimental access to this kind of structure because this would give you more knobs and testing means to see whether indeed you're dealing with a Majorana. So here are some numerical simulations. You can put that on the computer and calculate the current. So here are some showing you that there's such a zero mode. Also in the transport then shows up, and I can have the magnetic field here, and this is this zero energy line, and you see there are oscillations, I hope you can see it in the back, and these oscillations are splitting of the Majorana, so they start to overlap, and when they overlap, they hybridize, so they split away from zero, but because of these real oscillations, there are nodes, and the my runner has to come back to these nodes with function magnetic. But also what needs to happen is that the amplitude of these oscillations grows, because the overlap becomes bigger and bigger as a function magnetic field, the psi is more and more extended, the correlation length, and therefore the overlap grows. So this here is this very strong spinoid interaction, and it takes much longer before the splitting happens. So I'm just flashing here the most recent experiment on Majorana fermions by Charlie Marcus' group in Copenhagen, very similar structure which I introduced before. And they indeed see these nice oscillations. I'm not going out into much detail how they measured it, but essentially what you see here are these oscillations which are supposed to correspond to the splitting of the Majorana, also as a function of the magnetic field. That's an indium nanowire, and you apply the magnetic field along the wire in the order of a few hundred millitesla, and indeed you see these oscillations. However, these oscillations, and it's a little bit of a mystery, the amplitude actually decreases. And this is something which is typical for this field. There are sometimes in the experiment features which fit very nicely what we expect from the experiment, but sometimes there are also features which we do not understand yet. So I think this is still an open question, interesting to find out why this is. Good. So I introduce now this concept of Majoranas based on the spin orbit. Here's again the spectrum. And as I said in the beginning, it's by demanding to tune the chemical potential. That means you need wires with gates, and if you have metals around it, it's difficult to tune the chemical potential inside the wire. And so one can wonder, is it possible to avoid that? Can we have schemes where we do not need to do this kind of tuning here? And the answer is yes, and I will argue now a little bit with this. First, I would like to make the following comment. Here is a Rajpa spectrum, once more, with magnetic field indicated here by the field lines from the outside. And it's a uniform magnetic field which I apply along the wire and I open it here. And technically or formally, I can introduce a phase, a rotating phase, which depends on the spin, and perform a gauge transformation of my fermion operator. And what happens then is that I shift these two parameters back into each other, but the magnetic field which I applied, the uniform one, gets rotated. This is shown in this picture here, that the parameters come back to each other, but then, let's say, on the left hand side, the downspin has a gap, and on the right hand side, the upspin has a gap. The spectrum itself is of course not gapped like here, and which spin is gapped depends on the rotation, whether I go right or left handed chirality of this magnetic field. But this immediately tells you that you can actually do, you know, you can get exactly the same effect without any spin orbit, but instead by applying from the outside a rotating magnetic field in space. And what is also interesting is that the wave vector at which this happens is given here now by the spin orbit, and the spin orbit is tuned to the Fermi wave vector, so that's the pitch of the magnetic field. The period of this magnetic field is essentially given then by the spin orbit lengths or by the Fermi wave lengths. Good. And now let's go one step further and look at the following system. Let's look at a wire which has also spin impurities in there. And let's assume it's completely filled. So at each lattice side I have a fixed magnetic moment, and I have itinerant electrons in this conduction wire with the lattice constant, which is much smaller than the Fermi wavelengths of my electrons in there. I put that on a superconductor, and I want to introduce some proximity effect in this wire and see what happens. This kind of system was motivated by an experiment by Ari Astavi in Princeton, where he looked at iron atoms put on top of a superconductor of lead. And here are some pictures of these iron atomic wires, there's some chunk in between. We'll show you more pictures of that. And so, the question then we ask is it possible that these localized magnetic moments arrange themselves in form of a spiral of a magnetic spiral, and that this magnetic spiral will act back then on the electrons and open the gaps in the way I just showed before. And I will argue now a little bit here how this indeed can happen. So here is the Hamiltonian which describes the interaction between the localized moment, I as one spin moment here, and sigma is the spin of the itinerant electron. And so it's an on-site interaction at each site, I have this kind of interaction. And the interaction strength beta here, let's assume it's small, smaller than the Fermi energy, and we do now interpretive treatment of this type of coupling and integrate out the electronic degrees of freedom. But that's a standard thing to do, and you end up then with a so-called RKKY Hamiltonian, which describes then the interaction between the localized moments, spin interaction between the localized moments. This is now in Fourier space, pure Fourier mode. And the strength by which this is described is given by the spin susceptibility of the itinerant electrons. So this, we have an electron which comes by and makes a spin flip with a localized moment, goes to another localized spin, flips it back, but the electron goes out unchanged, but the two localized spins, they have a flip-flop process. And it's this strength here, chi of q, which can determine what the structure of my localized spins will be, the spin structure. And so when you look now at this chi of q in the presence of a superconducting gap, this is plotted here as a function chi, spin susceptibility as a function of wave vector q scaled with the Fermi momentum, then you see that for q equals zero, it goes essentially to zero, this chi, and that means for very long wavelengths interaction, there is basically no interaction between the spins for q equals zero, and that's also what we should have, kind of Anderson-Suhl physics, that there should be no ferromagnetic order in the superconductor, pairs are too far away to order. But when you come closer on the distance of the Fermi wavelengths, then you see a pronounced peak emerging at KF, at twice KF actually. Okay, I forgot. And this peak also appears in the normal state, and it remains when you turn on superconductivity, but it's a little bit cut off. Actually, it's a logarithmic divergence here on the scale of the superconducting gap over the Fermi energy. And it only happens, this peak, in one dimension. And if you go to two or three dimensions, then it's not there. And it's this pronounced peak which one can invoke or use to say that in this expression here, the contribution which is most dominant is around 2 pf. And that basically means that the ordering of the spins is preferred when there is a spiral and have a wave vector in there. So you can see actually that this minimizes this Hamiltonian here. You could also think of a staggered magnetization, but rotating gives you a factor of the lower energy. And then you get arrangement of the localized spins which prefers to have a spiral order. In which direction, in which plane the spiral is not determined, that you need to have some symmetry breaking, must be in orbit or impurities. But once one is picked out, then such a spiral can exist. Now one can also ask them, of course, the question how stable it is against fluctuations and so forth, magnons around that state. But, they do destroy the order, but it takes a very long length, typically more than 10 or 100 micrometers for the parameters we are looking at. And the lengths here we are looking at are maybe 100 nanometers or micrometer at most. So this is a good order. But of course, the strength of the order depends on this prefactor and how big this peak here is. Now, okay, so now we have this ordered system, and this we can consider as just an external magnetic field now acting back as a mean field approximation, acting back on my electrons and doing exactly what I showed before, namely it opens a gap. Because here, if I draw now the spectrum again around the two Fermi points, that this rotating magnetic field has the feature that it has a momentum transfer possible. You see it's a 2 pf, so I can scatter by 2 pf momentum, and I can flip the spin. And so I can go here, let's say, from a spin down into a spin up from the right Fermi point, positive to the negative one, and that opens a gap. It opens only a partial gap, the other spin, because it depends on which direction priority I have the rotation. And I get then a gap, which is expressed in these material parameters, the coupling strength essentially between electron and spin. It's a kind of a back action. And now you add superconductivity on top of it, and basically we get the same physics as I showed you at the beginning, that there's now a competition of this gap produced by the helix and the superconducting gap, bearing, spin up and spin down, and you get in total then four gaps because of fourfold the chance to begin with, and the two dominant ones are the gap of the superconductor and this gap which determines the topological phase sensation. And again, when this intrinsic helix amplitude is larger than the pairing amplitude, proximity-induced pairing amplitude, you are in the topological phase, and you get Majorana constant. So you can play through some numbers here with iron chains. I'm not going through all of this. You can also have, for example, 3-5 materials, magnetic wires with doped by manganese atoms. Or, what is also very interesting, just to look at the nuclear spins. Now, the nuclear spins have a very weak interaction, typically a factor of 1,000 smaller coupling strengths in the RPQI interaction, and therefore the lower the temperature at which this will be seen is much, much lower. But still, it's an interesting avenue to go. I just flashed this here, in case you're interested, you can read this in this paper. We looked at this, for example, in carbon 13. Nanotubes and transition temperatures, which we found they are low, but still they should be reachable. Anyway, let me come now to a recent experiment where this has been looked at. So I mentioned the experiment by Ali Astani, and there was a similar experiment which is done in Basel at my university, my colleague Ernst Meyer. And here is a picture of these iron chains on lead 110. And here are then STM pictures, scanning tunneling microscope pictures. It's also was done in Princeton, but what they could do more in Basel was using atomic force microscopes and go along the chain. And there are some chains where they saw some very pronounced halo at the end of the chain. And also what they saw very nicely is the very atomistic structure, which is much more clearly seen here in the AFM picture compared to the STM. And it's also very clearly seen that this is a monoatomic chain. In the Princeton experiment, they interpret their data as a two-atom chain on top of each other, but here it's very clearly seen this is not. And temperature dependence, you see it at 5K and at 10K, there's nothing, it vanishes. And so there were actually two types of wires. It's also interesting, just to flash this briefly, so in Basel, they saw actually a pronounced halo. These are the wires they considered, and the Princeton group looked at wires like this, and they also had wires like this, but they discarded them because they thought this is junk at the end. But it's exactly this wire which had this nice halo, and with the AFM, where you have actually constant height monitoring, so the medical colleagues are very sure that this is not a piece of junk. And this wire also showed quite a large zero bias peak, around zero here, as shown here. Okay, so then we tried to interpret that. They did all the experiment and then, you know, almost read the paper. And then they told us that they had done the experiment. It's a little bit late, but still, they wanted to know whether they can. So here's also they went in along the wire with the STM and measured the local density of states, and this is the data here with these dots, and you see this very pronounced peak at the end of the wire and then going down with some oscillations. And using now this Majorana picture, which I showed you in the beginning, I think we had some wave function. So one can write down the wave function from the theory where we have the conclusion from k to zero and from the outer part. This gives two exponential decays, and this was actually necessary to fit this curve, that there were two exponentials, you could not fit it with one, and that gave the first indication that this indeed might be Majorana wave function, and from this fit one can deduce then the localization lengths, which are also in reasonable agreement here on the scale one is looking at a few angstroms, latticides. let me see. Right. And there were oscillations seen, especially in the longer part here, And a fully analysis experimental of the experimental data shown here showed that a very clear period, which we identified as the KF wave vector in the J, and that also had lengths, the Fermi wavelengths, of about 4 atomic distances, 1.5 nanometers. Now, if you look at this yellow curve here, there are very, very strong oscillations also inside the peak that is not seen in the experiment. This was a little bit puzzling. Smearing out in the tip, we moved that a little bit, but still there were oscillations. And then asked ourselves what happens actually with the Majorana at the end of the chain, because it's lying on a superconductor, can actually leak into the superconductor. And here is a plot of a simple numerical simulation of this Hamiltonian, where we simulate the Majorana, and on the left side, you are open to a superconductor, S-wave superconductor, so the Majorana can leak out, on the right-hand side not. And you can clearly see that these oscillations, which are very pronounced here, if there is no leaking, disappear on that side where we have leaking. This has to do with the fact that this oscillatory part can actually leak out much more easily into superconductor than the K equals zero. And that suppressed this oscillation, so that also seems to be going in the right direction. So there's much more tomography. Yelenadik is Dennis Chevalier, we have a poster actually this week. Okay, so then you can go backwards in that interpretation and then get the energy scale of this intrinsic field strength produced by the helix, and that's also reasonable. And all the numbers of that, they are within a reasonable range. And so that seems to be a consistent interpretation in terms of Majoranas. There are still open issues. We don't know what the field dependence is or length dependence. And a very open question is this here. This is a signal, which we associate with the Majorana fermion coming from the AFM. And I said in the beginning that the Majorana has no charge. And the atomic force microscope is not tunneling sensitive, but is sensitive to charges. And so the question is, how can actually such a tool see the Majorana? And so we believe that this has to do with the fact that the Majorana basically creates a change of the other wave functions of the bulk at the end and dispels them a little bit. This creates then a different charge environment. You're still working on this. Okay, good. How much time? I think I took way too much time. 5 minutes. Okay. Good, I will skip that. Sorry, Silas. Silas would like to have me. I can see him. Good, what is beyond the Majorana fermions? And I showed before that the Majorana fermion has this feature that when you square it, it squares to 1. And this concept can be generalized, and so one of the first generalization is that you take the power to an integer, positive integer, n here, which can be any integer, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so forth. The additional feature is if you have two such objects, a gamma and a gamma prime, and you interchange them, then for a fermion, you should just change the sign. So if n is 2, we have a Majorana fermion, I get here an e2 minus I pi, which gives me a minus 1, that's why we call it fermion. However, you can generalize this concept here and get an arbitrary phase, determined here by this number n, and then it's no longer a fermion, and that's why we call it a para-fermion. It's also a zero mode, that's what we would like to have, so no energy, and get it stuck at the zero energy. I mean, for first experiments, that's not really so important, but if you want to use it later, let's say for rating quantum computation, then it's good to have a stable zero. Now, why is it interesting also from an application point of view? And this is a Majorana fermion. If you grade it, you can only generate, grading can only generate 2 out of 4 gates, which give universal quantum computation. So you cannot generate by grading entanglement. So in the logic basis, Majorana fermions, when you exchange them with them, whatever you do, you cannot get 2-qubit gate, which is entangled. That is much better with the parafermion, so there are also non-abelian legs in which order you might interchange them with each other, but they are stronger, and you can actually get an entanglement, and you can even get a synod, which of this the best one to have in this context is the Fibonacci anion, where you can do everything. But let's stick now to the parafermion here. And in recent years, there's a number, or quite a number of proposals how to generate this kind of modes. And in contrast to Majorana's, you need here really interaction. Interaction is very important to get this kind of fractional statistics. And therefore, natural candidates for this are edge states of non-trivial phases in the quantum hole, fractional quantum hole, and a number of proposals are in this system. And there are proposals on wires with magnetic fields and superconductivity by Alexina and Stern, which comes closest to what people have done so far for the wires. We also started to work on this, and we wanted to have a system where we are not having competing mechanisms like strong magnetic fields and superconductivity. And I thought the scheme, which I briefly show here now, and this is a double Rochefort wire. So we think now of having instead of one wire, two wires, and the other strip here is the upper wire. This is the lower wire, and there's a superconductor which connects both of them, or connects two poles. We have a weak requirement that the spin orbit interaction, as before, of Rochefort type, should be not equal, not equal in direction or in amplitude of the solar parameter. And no magnetic field is required. That's an important issue. So we will end up actually then with Kramers pairs of all excitations, basically doubled because of this time reversal symmetry which is present in the system. So what is now the main idea? The main idea is this. Proximity effect can open a gap in this wire in the standard way, namely you can think of Cooper pairs injecting from the superconductor in this wire and opening gaps as I described before. And the same you can do with the low wire, Cooper pairs just going in low wire, opening gaps by proximity. However, there is a third process where the Cooper pairs can split. This is referred to as a cross-Andreev reflection process, where from the Cooper pair, one electron goes in the upper wire and one electron goes in the lower wire. And that also can lead to pair. And these are two different mechanisms. And then the question is, you know, which amplitude here can be stronger and in which regime do we need to go? Can we actually get some topological phases? And the answer to this is yes, under the condition that this cross-Andreev amplitude of pairing proximity gap becomes larger than the direct one. And at first sight, this looks paradoxical because you're separating the Cooper pair over a longer distance, and you should think that this should have less effect. So the first requirement for sure is that the width of the superconductor should be much smaller than the coherence length of the superconductor, such that the Cooper pair still are coherent. There are some other high requirements. But there is something which comes now to rescue, and that's interaction effect. If you look at this effect here, then you put two electrons into the same wire, and if you take now into account the charging effect or the interaction effect of the two electrons, then it's harder to put two electrons simultaneously in the same wire than just one in the upper and one in the lower. And so if you have interaction effects, then this helps to suppress the amplitude of this, and therefore it's possible that this can become dominant as a process. And as a matter of fact, in recent years, there were indeed experiments which demonstrated just this type of cross-Andreev that it can become dominant. So here we have a superconductor attached to the quantum here, and it was clearly shown that this cross-Andreev dominates over the direct one. So there were three groups, Schoenberger, with the high group, which recently demonstrated that. And now we want to extend this a little bit, have this over a longer distance, not only point-like, and see what then happens. And indeed, you can go now through this exercise, very similar as before, and then this cross-Andreev coupling plays the role of the same Andreev, as I had before. And therefore we get a competing mechanism between this constant wave and the direct amplitude. And if this constant wave is larger, the product, the square is larger than the product of the standard gap, then we are on the topological regime, we get Majorana's, we get now Majorana pairs because we have time reversal invariant electrons. Okay, so the standard story. But now I want to go a step further and look what happens. Can I get more than Majorana fermions? I see my chairman is pushing me brush up a little bit. Now it's not pedagogical, sorry. I go quickly. Now I go away from this point before at the chemical potential where the Waschbau interaction crosses here, or the bands cross here, and I go lower with the chemical potential. And I go lower to a value such that I get four Fermi points and all have equal distance. And so it's two KF over 3 compared to the previous one, and I get the two on the positive side, two on the negative side. And if I look now at the cross and wave, which would, for example, couple an upspin with a downspin, then I see that this is not possible anymore at zero momentum. And I would like to have zero momentum pairing, otherwise I get a lost state have low amplitude, and this will most likely open a very, very small gap. However, if I have now interaction in my system, scattering such that an electron can give me momentum to compensate for this total momentum, one here and one here, and because I have arranged everything with the chemical potential in such a way that this backscattering would account for the missing momentum, I get back a zero momentum pair and I can open a gap. And that means if there is no interaction, I will have no gap. If there is interaction, I have a gap, and the strength of the interaction will determine then how big that gap is. Good. So here's another picture, here's some stuff. Basically, you can map it, and then you will end up that indeed you have localized modes in the left and the right side, which satisfies now this criterion of being part of
equations.
Yes. Good. And then you can use this. I can give you some physical interpretation, but maybe a script. And you can also extend this to topological insulators, these edge states, this is what we did here, and you can get scene updates, and then you end up. I stop now, and thank you very much. And, yes.
I have such a question. When you consider the interaction, the Ruderman-Kittel interaction, there is a singularity at k equal to 2kf. But this singularity is well known for many decades, that it's screened by superconductivity. So it disappears, and it's, I think Gouraud's French scientist was the first one to notice this. What can you say about this?
Yeah, so as I said, in the normal state, you have a very high singularity, and this singularity is cut by the superconductor. I mean, physically, you can think like this. You have a Cooper pair, and one electron wants to be a helper in the RKQI. And if this goes too far away, so if localized spin is here and another one is here, and it goes too far away from its partner, then that correlation gets lost. And so you can only do it on the short distances, which are comparable to the Fermi wavelengths. But now here, we are talking about a semiconductor. So that means that Fermi wavelengths, or we are in a machine with low filling, the Fermi wavelengths is much longer than a typical lattice constant. So in a metal, you're absolutely right. If you would go to one-dimensional metal, short, then it would not happen. But here in this system, it's already enough to peak, so you get a logarithmic divergence, as I said before, which is cut by the gap over Fermi energy. And if the Fermi energy is tuned down, so we are typically talking about a few milli-electron volts, not electron volts, and that makes actually that the effect in those systems still operative.
More questions?
So I have a question about the operators of fermion. So for the Majorana, we can construct it like just a linear combination of certain spin 1/2 operators. So do we need some higher spin operators to construct parafermionic operators?
That's a very interesting and difficult question. I think, there are some scenarios where it is possible to construct it out of spin states. Actually, we have such a kind of work where we showed that if you take some spin lattice, let's say a Kagome lattice, and combine them in the right way, it's possible that the low energy excitations then turn out to be power fermions. But it's not as simple recipe as it is for the Majorana fermions, because they are still fermions. Yeah. And as I said before, there's just real part, imaginary parts, that's always possible in a definite combination. It's just volume of particles. Mm-hmm. And that is completely different here for the power fermions. But it's not excluded that you can still find a way to construct them.
Last question.
Yes, you showed a plot of the Majorana mode function for two different kinds of n, say it's a sharp n and one where there was some S wave superconductor. This one. So on the left, this mode is actually mostly outside of the wire, it looks like.
Yeah.
So should we expect to see some tunneling signal actually beyond where the wire stops?
Yeah, I mean, look, this is a one-dimensional model now, so it's a one-dimensional wire. And let's say if you go now to the real experiment, so the superconductor is three-dimensional underneath. And this is just to show, it doesn't, so that if the wave function goes a little bit down into the superconductor, you have some leakage, that this interference will be suppressed. That was it. Now, if it's really a one-dimensional system, you should see more signal out there. This is the first naive model of the real system, and we want to do now the modeling is the 3D supercomputer.
Okay, thank you.